I'd like to welcome you each to this inaugural Robert Barclay Institute symposium. The Robert Barclay Institute was approved officially by the faculty of Barclay College of March 4th, the Bible Ministries Division, and then after that, the faculty. My name is Kevin Mortimer, and I've been named the director of the Institute. The purpose of the Institute is that this scholarly resource supports Barclay College's efforts to give historic Quaker thought a vibrant place in campus life and to allow Robert Barclay and other early Quaker voices to speak effectively in today's world. The goals and aims of the Robert Barclay Institute fall under the identity, mission, and strategic plan objectives of Barclay College. The Institute itself is made up of faculty, administrators, students, alumni, affiliate scholars, and constituents. At this point, there's an advisory committee that's working with myself as director, and that advisory committee is made up of Derek Brown, Aaron Stokes, Jared Ross, Jesse Penna, Glenn Leppert, and Royce Frazier, all either faculty or administration here at Barclay College. So this inaugural institute, the two presenters are Derek Brown, and the responder will be Aaron Stokes. So how it will proceed is that Derek has done research, and this is significant research, so it's an academic presentation, and he will be speaking on the theme, All Are One in Christ Jesus, the Social Justice Actions of Early Quakers as an Example to Contemporary American Evangelicalism. Once Derek has completed his presentation, Aaron Stokes will be giving a 10-minute response to what Derek has presented, and he will be lifting out things that were especially helpful, and even challenges that he would find within Derek's presentation. Following that, I will be coming up and you will become a part of the dialogue. So you might be thinking, you're picking up on one thing that stimulates your thinking as this goes on. What would be a question that you would raise as part of the ongoing academic conversation? And so we will conclude our session with a time of thinking, probably 20 minutes or so of that. So I'd like to open with a short prayer and then introduce our speaker, Derek Brown. Father God, we thank you for how you are present with us, how you have been coming to us, not only through your Son physically, but through your Spirit spiritually. And we come together in honor and recognition of you, asking that this tremendous good news that we hold and embrace here at Barclay College would continue to go forth. Open our minds to hear from you, most of all, to be taught by you in this day through the good work that Derek and Aaron have done. Jesus, in your name, amen. So I'd like to introduce our inaugural speaker, Dr. Derek Brown, who works both in the undergraduate and in the graduate program to speak on the theme.
Good morning. Can you hear me okay? Please note that the microphone is for the electronic recording, and so we will project, which is fine, but if you're worried that the microphone is perhaps not projecting, that is what it is for. And I want to thank you all for coming, especially the college students, which 9:30 on a Saturday morning might as well be dawn. And so I appreciate them coming out to hear. The theme of my topic is the example of social justice provided by Quakerism for American evangelicalism. Social justice should be an established and central mission of the American Evangelical Church. The Church's role in social justice, though disputed, in the American religious conversation is borne out by the historical witness of the church, the theological understanding of God, and the testimony of Scripture. Scripture itself provides, through a plethora of voices, a unified vision that harmony and justice for creation was the original and then subsequently the ultimate goal of God. Gaston and Shakespeare, not that Shakespeare, a British theologian, provide an excellent summary of the biblical evidence for Christian social justice. We therefore claim that there is a trajectory running through the Bible, from the created gift of the world to the laws which challenge debt, enslavement, and dispossession, from the wisdom tradition which looks skeptically on wealth and thankless labor, to the prophets who directly challenge the oppression of the poorest members of society and the injustice handed out to paid workers, from the early Christian community holding all in common to the vision of the New Jerusalem, a world freed from exploitation, end quote. It can be safely posited that one of the core missions of the church, based on scriptural evidence, is to promote social justice. And a refusal or failure to integrate social justice into the ecclesiological mission cannot be scripturally or theologically defended. Concordantly, rather than abstractly theorized or philosophically debated, justice is to be lived out through the concrete actions of the communities of faith. However, in spite of the vast biblical support, the social justice mission within American evangelical Christianity is often underrepresented or marginalized. This occurs for various reasons, however, none are justified. But especially since many social justice goals require independence from political or economic partisanism. The alignment of many evangelical churches to specific political and economic ideologies has resulted in a division and dissipation of social justice efforts. To achieve the aims of Christian social justice, the American evangelical church must refrain from either alignment or abandonment with the dominant political and economic establishment, and instead utilize its independence to challenge systemic injustice discerned in society, regardless of its political, economic, or cultural source. However, there is not definitive evidence that such an engagement has or would even occur. To aid the American Evangelical Church in achieving such engagement, the utilization, as an example, of the historic Quaker movement, which did have social justice mission as a foundational principle, would provide possible examples for the contemporary church to innovate its praxis. The first 50 years of the Religious Society of Friends, hereafter referred to as Quakers, provide such an example. For an early Quaker theology and praxis was rooted in the concept of biblical justice promoted within society. The Religious Society of Friends achieved much in the way of societal reform, in spite of its relatively small number of adherents. However, in this small size, and it is this small size, coupled with other factors, which have made Quakerism a movement that is little known, apart from the stereotypical appearances in pop culture, Quaker Oats, etc. However, the Quaker movement, despite its marginalization in the Christian consciousness, can and should speak to the condition of contemporary American evangelicalism, especially in the terms of American evangelicals' church work in the realm of social justice. The early Quakers, while remaining theologically orthodox, challenged the religious and societal status quo, specifically targeting social inequities as they perceive them. Their confrontation of social injustice was seen in what I term prophetic negation, in which the refusal to participate in systemically unjust societal norms raised awareness of social injustice in the social consciousness. The early Quakers' value, as an example for contemporary American evangelicalism, stems from the movement's origin in a society that was capitalistic, culturally Christian, and socially hierarchical, making the culture gap between early Quakers and contemporary American evangelicalism smaller than other historical Christian movements. The relevant areas exampled are social justice through speech, dress, pacifism, and ministerial pay. One of the issues regarding the attempts to model contemporary religious behavior upon historical models is that the geographical, societal, and cultural gaps, in addition to the chronological divide, make theological and ecclesiological choices regarding revivification of practices exceptionally difficult. The example of challenges faced by the Restoration Movement regarding doctrinal and practical disagreement seems especially apropos at this conference. Because of the often enormous difference between one's contemporary society and the historical examples of Christianity, any attempt at appropriation in toto runs into theological, ecclesiological, and practical difficulty. The notion that we can model today's church just off an example in the past with no changes whatsoever doesn't work. However, that does not mean we cannot use the examples and traditions of the past. However, the example of early Quakerism is attractive to the discussion of contemporary social justice for a few reasons. First, the historical situation which birthed the movement of Quakerism also, some centuries later, birthed what became the United States. However, that alone is not sufficient to warrant a comparison. But in addition to the common progenitor, an argument can be made that there are broad sociocultural themes that both Quakers in 17th century England and Christianity in the 21st century share. While this list is not exhaustive, nor does it ignore the undeniable, it shows the vast differences between the two settings. Rather, these similarities, however broad, provide some justification that utilizing Quakers as an example for contemporary evangelical Christianity is not an exercise in futility. The three main points of justification for utilizing early Quakerism as an example are dissatisfaction with the Christian establishment, social inequality communicated by social mores, and political upheaval. The Quaker movement, spearheaded by George Fox, emerged from a general discontent with the Church of England, a socio-religious establishment which, because of its political affiliations as a state church, blended political propaganda, a preservation of the status quo, and a fixation on money or revenue collected by the state with the religious teachings of Christianity. There was also a sense that the church, as an institution in 17th century England, was not reaching the spiritual needs of the younger seekers, appearing to disaffected believers as stale, lifeless religion, causing youth to leave the established church in search of a superior experience. Finally, the dissatisfaction with the government led to the overthrow and execution of Charles I, King Charles I, who was replaced with a demagogue who led a religiously fundamentalist government with a narrative of fear and uncertainty in the midst of severe economic turmoil. Let the hearer understand. These circumstances do mirror, however obliquely, similar societal issues facing American evangelicalism, and thus provide social justification for utilizing Quakerism as an example. The following are specific examples of social justice enacted by early Quakers. While by no means exhaustive, the list provides specific examples by which systemic injustice was highlighted and confronted. The examples from early Quakerism are speech, dress, pacifism, and ministerial pay. One of the early marks of Quaker social justice was the rejection of speech as a marker of social status. The social hierarchy of 17th century England was often communicated through the use of formal titles and the second person plural, you, when in direct communication with someone of a higher rank or class. This was in contraposition of the first person singular, thee and thou, utilized in communication with those of more intimate familiarity and or subordinate social rank. For example, if I met the president, I would use the plural you, but if I'm talking with Aaron, I would use the singular thou, because we are in equal standings. And just this nature of speech created automatic social hierarchy. You knew where you stood by how someone referred to you and how you referred to others. In contradistinction to this social hierarchy, the Quakers refused to use titles and spoke to everyone, regardless of social status, with the singular thou. This lack of decorum was viewed with great consternation, leading to even greater confrontations when local magistrates sent to investigate were treated with the same egalitarian posture, viewed, of course, as nearly treasonous insubordination. By refusing to utilize either titles or hierarchical language, the Quakers not only refused to acquiesce to the systemic injustice inherent in the language, but also raised the very issue of an equitable and prejudiced language, an issue that may have remained concealed within the status quo. To promote social justice, American evangelicalism should explore the way its liturgy, communication, and members utilize language that may be linguistically prejudiced or inequitable, no matter the intent regarding its use. By removing such language, confronting the use of prejudiced language, and emphasizing an equitable vocabulary, the church can not only begin to oppose systemic yet implicit inequities in society, but also raise awareness about such inequities within the general populace. Dress. To appreciate the Quaker testimony of simplicity regarding dress, an explanation of the fashions of 17th century England is required. The use of extensive finery and opulence in clothing not only communicated wealth, but also social standing, including aristocracy, royalty, and military rank. The refusal to follow the fashions of the day reflected the opposition to wasteful luxury, especially at the expense of charity to the poor. Quakers utilized simple clothing, including refusing the use of even silver in their buckles or buttons. While it may be argued that the simplicity of dress of later Quakers became an aim in itself, a way to just show the world that they were Quakers, the same cannot be said of early Quakers. The simplicity served an end, specifically as a social critique of the hierarchical and economic oppression occurring. The opulence and finery of the 17th century British aristocracy was gained, according to the Quakers, through systemic exploitation of the social lower classes. Richard Foster noted in his reference to William Penn that William Penn made a social critique that really anticipated the rhetoric of income equality in the United States, specifically, if you remember, the 99%. Penn perceived that it took the labor of 95% of the population to feed the consumer desires of the top 5%. George Fox, anticipating the economic arguments of trickle-down economics, disputes the notion that the consumer habits of the wealthy create jobs for the lower classes, accusing the wealthy, if you say, how shall the poor live if you do not wear that? Give them all the money which you bestow upon all the gorgeous attire and needless things. Give it instead to the poor, to nourish them, that they may live without making vanities, end quote. The simplicity of dress was a prophetic refusal to perpetuate unjust material inequality and raise the awareness of waste of consumer over consumption. American evangelicalism can and should avoid the trappings of power, prestige, and wealth. For in accepting the societal norms accompanying such wealth and social capital, the church may be unwillingly and unknowingly perpetuating social injustice embedded in the societal norms. While not calling for a poor church, per se, there is a call for the recognition of the consequences of wealthy hierarchism in the church. For example, the social prestige of the church and clergy have diminished over the past century. And there may be a subconscious drive to maintain social capital through the accumulation of wealth and assets. Because of the social tensions extant in contemporary culture regarding the perception of income inequality, the accumulation of wealth by the church can communicate inequality, bolster inequitable norms, regardless of the church's intent. Peace. The peace testimony of Quakerism represents a superlative example of social justice. Quakers abhorred violence and refused to participate in military conflicts. This refusal stemmed from the Quaker belief, supported by scripture, that every human represents the imago Dei, the image of God. Thus, violence not only harms the image of God, but violence as the first or main response, misunderstands the human condition. As Howard Brinton wrote, no human being is so depraved that nothing but force can appeal to him. Quakers refused to take the role of God in deciding who lives or dies, and also refused to participate in the collective guilt in conflicts which may emerge to be morally, ethically, or religiously unjust. The consequences of this peace testimony were severe in the turbulent political times. The emergence of the Quaker movement coincided with the English Civil War, and non-affiliation could be as dangerous as any single affiliation. However, the Quakers did not participate in armed conflicts, even at the cost of personal freedom. George Fox refused a commission as an officer of a militia company, a commission which would have freed him from his confinement in prison. His refusal set the standard for a Quaker response to the call to arms. However, it must be noted that in slight differentiation from other Christian peace movements, the Quakers supported the mandate of law enforcement to maintain law and order, which philosophically, in their minds, differed from war. However, the Quakers believed that police power should be exercised impartially, and they, quote, did not acknowledge the right of the magistrate to take human life for any reason whatsoever, end quote. Thus, while violence may be utilized by the magistrate to keep the peace, the power of the judiciary should be limited and accountable in order that the dignity of all persons be respected. American evangelicalism may face its toughest challenge in utilizing the Quaker example of peace. Given the current political climate, non-affiliation runs the risk of charges of unpatriotic, if not by radical Americans, treasonous behavior in the age of terrorism and war. Not only that, the peace testimony may be viewed as a quote-unquote liberal perspective, making it suspect by politically and socially conservative Christians. In addition, the foundational ethos of America, established in constitutional fidelity, created the potential for a conflict when the call for peace is viewed as a violation of one's Second Amendment. Thus, any social justice actions on the part of the American Evangelical Church relating to peace may result in backlash. The potential for backlash requires churches to count the cost of their commitment to the dignity of human life and the perseverance to stand behind this testimony. Additionally, the example of Quakerism provides an example of balancing the dignity and worth of human life with the mandate of the judiciary to provide law, order, and safety in society, utilizing force if necessary. The church must communicate the value of all human life and the mandate of law enforcement to enforce legislation, and also the necessity of magisterial accountability. In order that my colleague may have the time to give his reflection, let me skip to the end and say this. In addition to the specific examples of early Quakerism that were presented, there are also thematic considerations which require reflections. The following themes emerge from the study of the early Quaker social justice: response and the church and the state. Social injustice should not be viewed as a categorical unity by which one action response yields systemic revision to hegemonic oppression. Rather, injustice emerges in and through various aspects of the societal landscape, politics, economics, culture, etc. An example of this can be seen in the racism and prejudice existent in American society, even after social activists achieve their aim at the political level of recognizing African Americans as equal and integrated members of society. Social justice was achieved, and it should be celebrated, but it was achieved in part in one aspect of the continuum of racial injustice. Thus, while politically we achieve the aims, because it was on one aspect of the continuum, there is still the feeling that those in minority positions are under oppression and or attack by those who, while respecting the law, maintain racist or prejudicial views personally.
Thus, for the church, attempts at social justice and reform should not limit themselves to single actions, but varied responses across the spectrum of injustice, seeking through various modalities to prophetically engage the cultural narrative when it is contradistinctive to the kingdom narrative communicated by Scripture. The early Quakers represented a faithful attempt of cultural engagement in this matter and stand as an example for American evangelical Christianity to do likewise. The church and the state. One of the avenues by which the church has sought after social justice has been through the political process. It has been proposed that churches can and should be conduits between individuals and the state, organizational vehicles that facilitate community organization and involvement and the communication of information from the government to the people. The goal of such a partnership is the Christian influence upon the government, which in turn passes legislation reflecting Christian values. However, this idea is impractical, if not fallacious. For any attempt to enact social justice, even through political means, requires the church to be an agent of prophetic conflict rather than as a subordinate agent, which is a dangerous prospect for the church. Subordinate means in the sense where the church subsumes itself under a political ideology, i.e., if you're a Christian, you ought to be conservative or liberal, Republican or Democrat, etc. Even the example of Anna Greenberg, one of the proponents of the view that the church should be a subordinate agent to the government, gives an example of Quakers and their fight against slavery. This example is not appropriate, as the Quaker mission to abolish slavery was a movement challenging the dominant social and political norms, rather than as a reconciling agent between the populace and the state. This prophetic challenge is neatly summarized by Quaker scholar Doug Gwynn. The political power of the church lies less in an engagement with the political process than in its power to shift the social context of that process. By protesting systemic injustice through negation or a refusal to participate, prophetic outrage is reserved for the injustice itself rather than dissipated through divisive political rhetoric. The American Evangelical Church, rather than align itself or completely abandon the political process, should instead challenge systemic injustice embedded in the social cultural norms. These challenges, while not creating substantive changes in and of themselves, do raise awareness in the social consciousness, which can lead to future categorical changes in a society. In conclusion, while it should not have to be explicitly stated, the presence of justice within a community has been correlated with overall community wellness, while the presence or perception of injustice has the opposite effect. I believe that's common sense to many of us. If justice is perceived, the community benefits. If there's injustice, the community suffers. Thus, if a church wishes to increase the intrinsic wellness, what the Hebrew language calls shalom, of their surrounding community, one way to deliver this metaphorical cup of cold water to their community is through the promotion of an endeavor towards social justice within that community and the wider socio-political landscape. The example of early Quakerism reveals the power of prophetic negation or prophetic testimony through a refusal of participation. Rather than the church backing a specific policy or candidate and inadvertently perpetuating a corrupt system, the church should seek to remove itself from and protest systems of inequity. Thank you.
While the sound is being transferred from Derek to Aaron, I just want to say that one understanding that I think is very important in the inequities or equities being dealt with in speech and in dress and in wealth and in peace is that during the time of Robert Barclay, the church and state were not separated, it was all one, and a lot of the violence existed because of that. In fact, Robert Barclay, the namesake of this institution and of the institute itself. His descendants were, through his mother, Catherine Gordon. He was related to King James I, through which the King James Version of the Bible came through. He was a cousin then to King James' son, Charles I, who was beheaded 1 month after his birth. He lived during Oliver Cromwell's 10 years of the Puritan leadership in England, and his cousin then, Charles II, became king 1660 to 1685, of which he addresses his major apology for true Christian divinity to the king as well as other people. And then he became governor of what is now New Jersey before his death in 1690. It was in 1689 that the Edict of Tolerance was given. So there was profound confusion that existed in this historic environment. In response is Aaron Stokes, a master's student in Quaker studies.
All right. Thank you, Derek. In All Are One in Christ Jesus, Dr. Brown claims that social justice is a long forgotten, if not adversarial, concern within the evangelical community. He also argues that Friends tradition provides a powerful example to guide evangelicals back to the responsibility of opposing systemic injustices. I agree with him on both points and wish to develop them further by diagnosing what I believe to be the underlying cause of the decline and concern for society's welfare by evangelical Christians. Our present conundrum can be traced back to a single theological displacement that occurred at the turn of the 20th century, premillennialism as an answer to modernist liberal Christianity, which was itself not an isolated event, but the climax of an extended de-divinization of the cosmos, secularization. This change took the evangelical branch of Friends along with it. Therefore, it may be difficult to see Quakers as a proper example here. In this sense, Friends have just as much to learn from their own past as the broader evangelical community. For within Friends' history lies not only the practical examples mentioned by Dr. Brown, but the proper theological motivation behind them. Effecting any real change in society will require not just an amendment of praxis, but a reclamation of the concept of the sacramental universe and an overhaul of our eschatology. There was not always such a dearth of social reform efforts present in evangelicalism. At the beginning of the movement's history, the welfare of society was a persistent and natural concern among evangelicals. Mark Knoll writes that evangelicals were never as successful at fleeing the world as they thought they should be. The ironic result of that failure was a rich, if also complex, record of social, political, institutional, and intellectual engagement. This record included engagement in prison reform, anti-slavery initiatives, education to the marginalized, opposition to abuses of power, and many other enterprises. For over a century, evangelicals were deeply involved in the affairs of the world and even made it a centerpiece of their work, recognizing that true reform could only come from a converted heart. In order to understand this early evangelical relationship to the world and the subsequent distancing, one must understand the soil in which it grew, that is, the age of the Enlightenment. Many of the modernist characteristics that developed during the era were shaped by Christianity, and in turn shaped Christianity. Modernity, as defined by the preeminent sociologist Anthony Giddens, is a shorthand term for modern society or industrial civilization portrayed in more detail as it is associated with, one, a certain set of attitudes toward the world, the idea that the world is open to transformation by human intervention. Two, a complex of economic institutions, especially industrial production and a market economy. Three, a certain range of political institutions, including the nation state and mass democracy. Largely as a result of these characteristics, modernity is vastly more dynamic than any previous type of social order. It is a society, more technically a complex of institutions which, unlike any preceding cultures, lives in the future rather than in the past. Intellectual and technological achievements produced an exaggerated optimism regarding humanity. There was, and continues to this day, be a very real belief that humans can accomplish anything. While modernity is now largely seen by conservative Christians as the enemy of faith, many scholars have argued that its source was within Christianity itself, and the events of the Reformation in particular. Over the course of the 18th and 19th centuries, God was perceived to be increasingly transcendent in society due to the Protestant negation of all forms of mediation of the divine. No longer could God be found in places through the prayers of the saints or in the sacraments. It became only possible to experience God through the scriptures and by grace. This narrow means of divine interaction set the stage for an exclusively human and thus secular world. As Peter Berger sharply writes, a sky empty of angels becomes open to the intervention of the astronomer and eventually of the astronaut. The devaluation of creation presents us with a false dichotomy between matter and spirit. The very idea of salvation shifts from a holistic consideration to one purely situated in the spiritual realm. In a sermon on the subject, John Wesley defines salvation as both a present and future reality. He furthermore claimed that works of mercy were evidence of a repentant heart. Feeding the hungry, clothing the naked, entertaining the stranger, visiting those that are in prison or sick or variously afflicted, these are the things to which Wesley suggested Christians should devote themselves as they awaited complete salvation. These efforts to reform society remained central to the evangelical outlook until the last quarter of the 1800s, when a new generation of evangelicals emerged, led by D.L. Moody and others, proposing a premillennial eschatology. According to Marsden, no longer was the goal to build a perfect society. At best, it was to restrain evil until the Lord returned. This shift by a growing number of evangelicals from optimistically bringing about the kingdom of God through societal reform to viewing the world as inescapably doomed was a process largely motivated by the complementary fears of a changing world and developments from within Christianity itself. In American Apocalypse, historian Matthew Sutton writes that the perception of this group was that true Christianity, and by extension their very way of life, was being threatened. He goes on to write that, quote, they viewed liberal Protestantism and movements like the social gospel as troubling distortions of Christianity that had seemingly transformed religion into little more than a shallow nostrum for curing temporal problems. Premillennialism seeped into the popular opinion with the publication of Jesus is Coming by William E. Blackstone in 1887. He was a realtor in Chicago and a good friend of D.L. Moody. Reverberations from that little book, which sold more than a million copies in over 40 different languages by the time of the author's death in 1935, continue to be felt today. In it, Blackstone argues that, contrary to some arguments, a premillennial theology is incredibly practical. He lists 40 implications, all of which are supported by Scripture, to the life of a Christian, none of which concern engagement with the world, but a complete withdrawal. While this was not the only sentiment of evangelicals at the time, it does represent a significant number and was the philosophy espoused by influential leaders of the movement such as Cyrus Scofield and John Darby. I've thus far gone to great lengths to demonstrate the evangelical break from a concern with anything but the spiritual conditions of people. As I mentioned above, this is the story not only of the broader evangelical movement, but the Society of Friends as well. However, like the evangelicals to which most Friends have aligned themselves, there is clear evidence of social interests in the early tradition. Dr. Brown thoroughly explicated these interests and the political and social context, which gave birth to the Quaker movement. I will now detail the theological impetus behind the events. Compared to the later evangelical eschatology that championed the premillennial approach, the first generation of Friends espoused what Pink Dandelion calls a realizing eschatology, which recognized the second coming as an inward reality. In other words, early Friends rejected the idea of waiting in an eschatological meantime for the return of Christ. Dandelion cites the Quaker response to the Eucharist in particular. Quote, for Fox, the injunction in 1 Corinthians 11:26 to break bread until the Lord came again had been superseded by his coming. Indeed, Fox went on to say that Christians had already been called to a different supper, that is the inward marriage supper of the Lamb described in Revelation 3:20, end quote. These friends believed that they were helping to manifest the kingdom of God through both their preaching and their actions, which stood in stark contrast to the decrepit political and ecclesiastical realities around them. This vision, identified by Lloyd Lee Wilson as gospel order, is perhaps the key to understanding early friends and their expression of the Christian message. It is a way of living in right relationship to every other aspect of creation and to the Creator. And it gave friends the motivation to refuse participation in systemic injustices, no matter how deeply ingrained in the culture they were. Early friends, Wilson writes, were not waiting for the second coming at some future time, but joyfully and publicly witnessing that the kingdom of God had come among them already. Therefore, social reform was more than a mere concern to these friends. It was the natural implication of living in a new reality, that of the peaceable kingdom. In order for social reform to reclaim its centrality in the Christian identity, evangelicals and friends alike are going to have to answer one fundamental question. Is the world, in its entirety, and not just the spiritual component, worth saving? According to Dr. Brown, theology, church history, and sacred scriptures all point to the affirmative. However, for the present evangelical community to come into agreement with this fact, they're going to have to overcome one major hurdle: relearning to see the cosmos as infused with the divine. This alone will give purpose to social justice, that is, the physical, emotional, social, and intellectual revelation of the kingdom of God alongside the spiritual. We must not only learn to act like the early friends, but see the world in the same sacred way. Thank you.
I want to thank Dr. Brown and Aaron Stokes for their presentations. And now's the opportunity for you to raise whatever question that grabbed you during the listening of their very developed research and presentation. And so whatever question that you might have, to address them, to open up, these become the questions that future research and study begins to deal with. So if you would acknowledge me by raising your hand, and then I'll bring the microphone to you so that it can be recorded as well. Any thoughts or reflections? Who would like to go first?
Something I've struggled with for a long time is the whole thing of the peace testimony and not killing another person. Is that I think I could do that for myself, but if someone were attacking my child, I think I would do everything possible, including killing them, to save my child. Or if they were attacking me and I know my child is next, I would kill them before I'd let them kill my own child. So that is something that I would like. What would the early Quakers do in that situation?
I think you bring up a good point, and I, as a father, as a husband, I cannot but affirm that instinct to do whatever it takes. So on one hand, I'm affirming, yes, in a situation like that, it would be tempting. Do you want us to?
Yeah, you guys move to the center here so we make sure and get you on.
I want to affirm that, yes, I don't think, I respect the question. However, I think the problem with such a question is that when we think about these testimonies or even any philosophical category, our instinct is to go to the extreme example. So if I were to say stealing is wrong, someone could come back and say, well, what if your family is starving and your daughter will starve to death if you don't take the bread? Is stealing wrong? Now, the person is caught in kind of a catch-22 because he says,
no, he shouldn't steal. Well, he's a moral monster, that he would allow his child to starve to keep a testimony. That's keeping the letter of the law, not the spirit. If he says, yes, he can steal, well, in some people's minds, he's negated the entire testimony. You know, so I think the question is to recognize, yes, there are extreme examples which belie the common sense, rational, boxed answers. And I think that is between us and the Lord. When I think about peace, I think we must move away from these extreme examples and think about kind of the general application. Yes, there may be a time where your family is starving and you may be forced to take a pie off the windowsill. However, that does not mean that a prohibition of stealing is not a general a good source of well-being for the community. Would we all agree for that? That the general principle is good, extreme examples exist. In the same way, I would say this, that one can be a pacifist, and pacifism, like anything else, is a continuum. One can recognize that peace is the goal of God, that one would not desire to participate in unjust conflict or viewing conflict as unjust, but also recognizing that there are police officers, soldiers, people who face death or action. And I refuse to judge people in those situations. So as a principle, yes, I hold to it, recognizing that life is messy and God is understanding. Does that make sense?
Yeah, and you affirmed in your presentation that there are, they affirmed the justices of peace, so to speak. You affirmed that as part of their process. But he else, all are one in Christ Jesus. The social justice actions of early Quakers as an example to contemporary American evangelicalism. Yes. One in the back here.
Yeah, so kind of getting to the practical of what you're speaking about, I'm just going to ask a clarifying question. So you're saying the way that we begin to either one, I'm thinking more about Aaron, what Aaron just presented, but it ties in exactly to yours. So the way that we begin to make this change come about is in our own personal lives, we begin to change. And this will, in fact, affect the social evangelical world, to say. So by doing that, by changing ourselves, we begin to affect and bring into awareness in the conscious of the evangelical world. Is that correct?
Does it start within? Is that what you're asking? Yeah, I think that we're so used to, and maybe this is just a product of being in a democracy. We're so used to striving for these big societal changes that's where the real changes occur. But I really think a grassroots approach, beginning with the self, is much more effective. I think in terms of, we're talking about the peace testimony, I think in terms of the peace testimony, we can fight war, you know, till the end of time, and still there are going to be wars. But what does it look like for peace between me and my family members, between me and my coworkers? That's where the real crucible is, you know. How do I respond to these people? Is it with anger or is it with a sense of peace? And so I think that when we begin to change those things, I think that we really can start changing society. But
I think it's paradoxical, because I agree wholeheartedly. However, I lean towards more larger societal changes and shifts, because I think we fail to realize how much our culture and society imprints on us and our church culture, even in discipleship. For example, there were
a lot of God-fearing, Jesus-loving, Bible-believing Christians in the South before the Civil War who totally accepted slavery as an institution. Now, how can that be? Well, because as they were being discipled, brought up, preached to, taught, the cultural norms affected their worldview. And so I think it's a both and, because as you change individually, the hope is that you move past and provide. Otherwise, you will always be shaped by the culture. And you can look at any culture historically, God-loving, Bible-believing Christians who lived in a society that promoted outrageous injustice. Like in the South, some of the largest slave owners in urban areas were the Anglican ministers themselves. So how can a preacher preach against it when their welfare and their wealth is built on that? The system is aligned against that. And I would dare say that the reason that the Carolina Quakers fled the Carolinas during the war and before is because their individual convictions led into very, very, very tough conflict with the societal norms, which, not that they, I want to say this, sometimes they're so embedded, it's hard for us to even recognize that what was wrong. I mean, the slave-owning Christians had scripture. They didn't see what the abolitionists were even saying. And I wonder today, as we are shaped by our culture, what injustices or illnesses do we accept as Christians that in 100 years we're going to look back and go, wow, we as a church let that happen to our shame. And so I agree 100% with you, but I think there is a deeper issue at play of what society imprints on us.
Yeah, just to affirm, the Quakers were actually, in focusing on true Christian divinity, were between the government, who had dominated who the church was, and who the other people who were trying through government to enforce their thing. So in a sense, Quakers were caught right in the middle between the protesting movement, of which they would be considered, and the government themselves, and were hit from both sides. But wanting a holistic, not just a spiritual, but spiritual, not separating the spiritual and the physical realities of evangelicalism. Eric, did you have a question?
I have a question for Aaron. I noticed in your presentation, you mentioned that for early Quakers, apparently their eschatological view was, did you say premillennialism or something like that?
No, they're quite the opposite, actually. Premillennialism is we're awaiting Christ. The Quakers said that he's already here in the form of his spirit.
Okay. So I've read a bit of Barclay's apology for a class, and I noticed in the introduction where he refers to himself and other Quakers as those who have already beat their swords into plowshares, the like. And I shared it with a friend, and she noticed that and thought, that's weird. That usually is used in eschatological writing. So did they literally believe that Christ has already come, that his second coming is already fulfilled, or did they use that mostly to encourage acting with social justice while still awaiting the return of Christ?
Yeah, both. It's a present and a future reality. The problem with the premillennialist approach is that it's an entirely future reality. There's nothing we can do. God's gonna, eventually come down here and destroy everything, so what's the point in saving everything? But the Quakers believe that the second coming had already been inaugurated, and the historical arrival of Christ continued in his spirit, and then we will see Christ again in the future. But what that means is that we have the very real possibility to reveal the kingdom of God here and now. When we look at the Sermon on the Mount in particular, some people say, well, that's just idealistic perspective, that's how it'll look in the future. But the Quakers said, no, this is what the world is supposed to look like now. And we can, not just by our preaching, but by our very actions, show heaven on earth. So it's both. You know, it's a waiting, but it's also a very present reality.
Okay, Jeff?
I appreciate your presentation very much today. Several thoughts are going through my head. I'll focus on one thing that stands out. One of you said something about how the extent to which culture has become embedded in our thinking that we don't even recognize that sometimes. And when you begin to deal with a passage like the Sermon on the Mount, you begin to realize how true that really is. Having now been introduced to an Anabaptist perspective on that, Anabaptists made that the core of their faith and practice, and I've appreciated that emphasis as well. But that all leads me into more of a suggestion than a question, perhaps for a future presentation, and that is coming to terms with the depth to which civil religion has shaped our worldview and how we deal with that so we can even begin to see an early Quaker perspective or a new contemporary way of looking at the world and spirituality in all those areas. So that would be a suggestion perhaps for our future presentation. You have both indicated that in your presentation, but it seems like for the church to really deal with that, we've got to admit there is this civil religion perspective that grips us.
Yeah, and I affirm that. How does the evangelical message, how is it physical, not just a spiritual concept?
And kind of building off of the last question or suggestion, what would you guys suggest in both the church wanting to be kind of an outside of societal influence for society, how would you encourage us to not that in and of itself become like a hierarchy, that like we're better than society, to be both outside but also influencing?
I think service is what distinguishes the lording over that the Gentiles are known for. So instead, as a negation of what the world says, the greatest among us must be a servant. And so I think we see that example of the absolute truth that Christ could have dictated in the sky with heavenly armies of angels. He instead spoke through the washing of his disciples' feet. And so, yeah, we could easily become another power source. We're better, we know it, etc. Instead, our cultural critique is shown in both the intentionality of our service to the world and I think also our integrity. The reason that many Christian voices in politics have been marginalized is because we have our blinders on. We accuse one person of this and another not that. We don't look with objective lenses. And so really focusing on how can we have integrity in our message before finding the speck in society's eye as well.
And I think part of that is the very language that we use. If you look at the Old Testament prophets, the language is we. It's not you, it's we. There's an inclusion in those injustices. And I think if we ourselves admit the place that we've held in perpetuating things like racism or social inequality, these different things, if we admit our own participation in these things to begin with, that I think will help, but the language we use.
Good question is related to how do we, the detached, become very profoundly inclusive as opposed to remaining in this detached, and what does that begin to look like evangelically? Yes. We have probably about five more minutes here.
This is a question for Aaron. So in your presentation, you made the connection between premillennial eschatology and a withdrawal from the social justice work. Are you saying that those views are incompatible, and or are you promoting amillennialism?
No, if you look at the history, there were a lot of Christians still at that time that were doing social justice type things, the temperance movements and different things like that were going on at the time. And so it wasn't, I don't think they're exclusive, but I think what we really have to do is see creation as secular, not secular, but sacred, and sort of remove that idea that God is not here, God is out there, and when he comes back, then we'll be okay. You know, God is already here. And so I think it's a return to the both and, looking at the kingdom as a present reality and a future reality. And so that answer the question? I don't know. All right, you're asking if they're incompatible. I don't know. Maybe they are. I don't know. You teach eschatology. Yeah.
Well, yeah. But I would say no, they're not incompatible. I think it just comes down to praxis. We just don't praxis. You can be premillennial or amillennial, an idealist or literalist of Revelation. The message of Revelation is persevere for God wins. And so the rest is, you can hang all of Revelation on that peg. And so the rest is just commentary. And so, premillennialism is not antithetical to social activism. But I think what he's saying is, once again, sometimes we're unaware of the mindsets that come when we adopt theology. And if we're not aware that we're maybe failing to practice it well or as it's intended, that's when issues. As I teach my class, your eschatology often determines your ethics. And if you have a wrong understanding of the fullness of God's arrival, appearance, and return, that's going to affect the way you interact with others.
Yeah, I think we have, there's two more questions here, or two more hands, and then...
Well, this is just a comment. I'm surprised that you didn't use the quote, live in the light of the life that takes away all occasion for war. And what would that look like in that peace testimony? And when I think about some of that, early Quakers here in the United States would plant lots of corn, expecting a lot of that corn would be gone when it came harvest time. So they knew that there would be people that were hungry and that they would need that. And so they planned ahead what it would look like, and it didn't matter that somebody took it because they were hungry. And so what does that look like, for part of our peace testimony to plan ahead for those who are in poverty so we don't have to be judgmental because we know not everybody has. So we need to help provide for those who do not. And so I'm kind of surprised that one Quaker quote that I think is very near and dear to my heart that is a foundation of the Quaker peace testimony. So it's just kind of a thought.
Yeah, I appreciate you sharing that. I think you also know that Quaker testimonies are simplicity, peace, integrity, community, quality, and quotes. We loved writing stuff down and having quotes. And so forgive me, but there is often a plethora. But you're right. Why is it, and I don't want to attack, why is it that oftentimes the church is found on either side of a conflict and not in the middle, helping, serving? I'm not aware of the spiritual foundations of the Red Cross, but the reason that the Red Cross is so effective is that it serves, regardless of ideology. And what if the church was that way, providing that metaphorical corn to the wounded, sick, the refugees, and so on? I think churches do that, but I don't think it's part of our testimony because we get lost in the calls, no matter what country you're in, of patriotism et cetera. And so, yeah, what if we stepped away and just said, we're gonna be the church. Watch out.
Last question.
As you were talking, Dr. Brown, one of the things that popped out at me was your line about the state of the church when George Fox and the Quakers got started. And I thought, dang, that kind of sounds like today. So I guess, how is that? So do you see parallels between those two? And the Quakers were very proactive and said, there is stuff that we need to change, so let's change it. So if there are parallels, what does that mean for us today? And how can we think more proactively rather than just sitting back and saying, oh, woe is us?
I'd like both of us to answer that. My theological answer, kind of rooted in my discipline of organizational theory and my graduate work in biblical studies, is I don't know. I don't know what that looks like. Because if you look at George Fox, we have our visiting scholar, Katie, here. If you look at George Fox, he was ultimately led by the Spirit after studying and being rooted in God's Word. So he was saturated in God's word, which he considered absolute truth. And he was led by the Spirit of God, which seemed to have led him to this place. And so I dare not prescribe actions, but merely themes that we need to be aware of. But I think it comes down to, are we truly listening to what Scripture says and are truly obedient to the Spirit? And what would that look like? What would be raised out amongst the students at Barclay? How would God call one out to provide something different? And if God did call that person out, could they handle the same sort of persecution that George Fox did, 15 or more years in prison, et cetera, to show the world that God is not through with this world yet, and neither should the church? So a short answer is I don't know, but I think we, A, need to get back to our spiritual foundations and also our social justice foundations as well.
I think part of it also is listening. You know, the Quakers and there were a ton of other dissenters, they were called at the time, were arising, and these were people that were just, you know, fed up with what was going on. And there was the church present saying, you know, trying to squash these attempts and saying this isn't the way it is and different things like that. And I think we do that today. And the difference now is that we are the institution. We're not the dissenters anymore. We are the institution. And so we are imposing those views on anybody who tries to challenge them. And so what would it look like if we actually listened to what people are saying instead of saying, oh, these crazy post-millennial hipsters, postmodernists, and these
guys.
You know, instead of doing that, what would it look like to actually listen and hear the concerns and say, you know, how can we change what we're doing instead of holding on to it so tightly that it has to come to a split or you know, different things like that. So I think listening. People are telling us. People are telling us what's wrong. We just have to listen.
I want to thank you for your presentations and for your questions that were raised. And so let's give them a round of applause. So thank you for being a part of this, and those of you who would be viewing through on the web. We also invite your comments as well. We trust that the things that began in this academic presentation, that we will learn fresh and new things and begin to deal with those as we understand this Quaker expression of what Robert Barclay called true Christian divinity being an expression somehow of all people and not separating the spiritual and the physical, also in the complexity of government and church and others as well. Thank you for coming.